We know how all that. And so I'm really grateful that he's here now. So Daniel is a very distinguished scientist. Got his undergraduate degree at Cornell University before his 19th birthday. He got his PhD in 1979 from Harvard. He spent 8 years at Bell Labs, 3 years as a professor of physics at Princeton, 15 years as a physics professor at Harvard, where he's really good friends with Larry Summers. We know how that happened. And for the past 16 years, he's been at Stanford University. He has a lot of important contributions to disordered systems, and he won the 2013 Lars Onsager Prize in the APS for those contributions. He's been a member of the National Academy of Sciences. In the past 15 years, he's transferred more to biophysics. And I have to say a fun fact about Daniel. And so the only fun fact I know is that David Bishop, who got his PhD at Cornell University, and he told me Daniel Fisher stories. And one Daniel Fisher story is that Daniel was an undergraduate taking the graduate courses at Cornell University, and the graduate students are basically saying, "Hey, Daniel, ease up, you're killing us."
So, that's it. It's very nice to be here. I think I was actually supposed to have come about 6 years ago. Jeffrey, and I don't know whatever happened with that. There wasn't the pandemic, but something happened in between. So anyway, it's very nice to be here. This is my first time here, except once popping in to see a friend. So I guess I'm disappointed that Sid, who I know known for quite a long time, that he only had could think of one amusing story. I don't know. I know the other boring things. But, so. Okay, so this talk is going to primarily focus on questions and some theoretical work on trying to get some answers. And so the main question sort of motivating is, why is there so much fine-scale microbial diversity? So you've surely all heard of the diversity of bacteria in your guts and many different species and so on, but your gut is a very complicated environment. But it turns out it's become clear in recent years that the finer and finer one looks, so within bacterial species, that you can look in a single location and you'll find coexisting strains, substrains, sub-substrains, and so on, directly competing with each other. Okay, so to me, this is very surprising because I thought, you know, survival of the fittest was supposed to wipe out most of them if they were all doing similar things. So this is the motivating question. And initially, I'm going to show one example of some data that's particularly relevant for this. And then come to the theoretical aspects, which is trying to ask what we can gain by thinking about sort of high-dimensional biology and the questions that come from that. And then I'll focus on simple models, particularly coupling together the ecological and evolutionary dynamics. So one of the goals here is really to ask, you know, what should one maybe not be surprised by? This is an important role of theory. You know, you're surprised by something, even if you have some simple models that are not realistic that give some of that phenomena. You say, okay, it doesn't work like that, but maybe I shouldn't be so so surprised. So here's then the example of the diversity of Prochlorococcus, which is a cyanobacteria, photosynthetic bacteria. And by some measures, it's the most important organism, single species on the planet, including humans. It fixes more carbon than all the croplands put together and dominates photosynthesis in the tropical oceans. It's very simple. It's tiny. There are rather a lot of them, about 10 to the 27. And they're very diverse genetically, even though it's not at all clear how diverse they are phenotypically. So some work of a student, Milana Popula, is doing now, of just taking a lot of single-cell data collected by Penny Chisholm's group and looking at these single cells and seeing how they related to each other. So these the colors is not showing great here. So this is showing on a color scale, on a logarithmic scale, the distance between the genomes of these individual cells, sequences from individual cells. So this is saying how closely they are related. So over here, these are the main clades, some high light and low light and so on. These, the common ancestor is probably of order 100 million years ago. And then one goes to finer and finer scale structures here. And the closest cells that have been found are about 100 years diverged or 1,000 years diverged. Now, these are single cells. They're planktonic. They mix around. This is about the global mixing time scales for the tropical oceans. So we've got a huge amount of diversity of these simple organisms. They've been evolving together and competing all over the place for a very long time, right? So what on earth can sustain all of this diversity?
No, but wait a second. You said competing, but isn't there also some cooperative interactions too?
It's not known of any cooperative interactions.
Because the microbiome is a lot.
Yeah, the microbiome, there's a lot of cooperative. These are really simple. They're just floating around. They're competing for resources. They're eaten by other little bacteria. There are some ecological differences known at this level, but within this dominant, actually highlight two group, which by itself dominates all the photosynthesis. There's very little known about any ecological differences.
These samples, are they all from one place or all over the world?
So these samples are from multiple different places all over the world. A large fraction are actually from one place. And it's very hard if you pick a Pacific cell and Atlantic cell, you can't from the single cell tell which is which. If you take 100 Pacific cells and 100 Atlantic cells, you can. So it's, but that's one of the interesting questions is the spatial mixing things. So how can we characterize the diversity? Well, the one we can do a lot of is characterizing the genomic diversity. That's easy now with sequencing. It's very hard to do phenotypic diversity. You can grow these in the lab, but it's hard to do, and it's hard to measure many properties of them. So the work we want to try to do to be motivated by theory as to what kind of measures of diversity we want, and one wants to be able to distinguish between scenarios and, of course, focus on potentially universal features. So the simplest quantity one can look at, and a lot of data is like this, is you take a snapshot, right? We usually can't follow dynamics. You take a snapshot, see what species you have there or see what strains you have there, and one thing you can do is just plot the distribution of the abundances, sometimes called frequencies in the evolutionary and ecological context. So of course, what we would really like is spatial correlations of those, people have already asked, temporal correlations, correlations with the phylogeny, with the family trees, and so on, but those are harder to get. So this is now a classic example, not of a single species, but a single group of diatoms, which are, they're different from each other, but not in enormous ways. And people will say they, roughly speaking, occupy similar niches, not the same one. Okay. And if you look at the distribution of abundance here, this is in rank. So this is the rank here on a log scale, and this is the abundance. And you notice this slope here, and this looks like a rather straight line. And there's actually a theory that predicts this, and it's basically the only predictive theory in ecology that will predict things about abundances and abundance distribution. And this is the neutral theory of ecology that hypothesizes that there's no selective differences that matter, or at least they all average out in some way. There's no interactions. The dynamics are purely stochastic, birth, death, and migration. But it does have prediction that among the prediction is that the species abundance curve should just be 1 over n, and that's this dotted line here. Now, it's actually even more than that. It actually predicts spatial distributions as well with very few fit parameters. And the classic example here, for some reason, is trees in the Western Ghats part of India. So the question is, why on earth should the abundance statistics look as if many species are ecologically equivalent, right? Trees clearly are not ecologically equivalent. So to get this, it clearly has to be some sort of emergent property that comes out from the evolution and the ecology, and it isn't really going to be neutral. And that's even more so for bacteria, as I'll say in a minute. So what are the explanations for the diversity? Well, one of them I already mentioned, the neutral ecology. The problem with that with bacteria is the time scales for the stochastic fluctuations, births and deaths, for a very big population are much too slow to give rise to the kind of diversity that's seen. So this you can just rule out completely, at least for any bacteria that don't undergo very tight very tight bottlenecks.
Can you explain this? Because, right, if you have 10 to the 27, well, if you have 10 to the 27
right.
bacteria.
It takes 10 to the 27 generations for neutral fluctuations.
So, but then you would expect to see a lot of diversity.
But you wouldn't expect to see any diversity at substantial frequencies and so on. So you can't get anything that looks like this level of diversity from neutral processes. And you see very much from the genomic data that there's lots of selection processes have to be going on to drive it. So it's, yeah, I mean, when it needs a bit more detail of what exactly the diversity that one is seeing is.
And does that include considering all of the mixing processes in the ocean as well?
Well, so the mixing processes, there's not, at least no reason to believe that there are tight bottlenecks associated with the mixing processes. So if you basically to get something that would work, you would need to take all the Prochlorococcus in the ocean and bring them down to 1 square meter area and take the number that's there. And so you eliminate all of them except those would be how tight a bottleneck you would need to be able to get the kind of diversity that's seen. So it's very tight. It's different, like for pathogens that go from one person to another and do go through very tight bottlenecks.
It's a very controversial theory, I know, and I'm not promoting it, but I'm just curious. Does John Hart's Mac sense?
So that is basically the neutral theory, and you can do it as a maximum entropy. You know, maximum entropy is a religion, right? It's a thing to do in cases where you've got extensivity and things that are approximately independent. But going beyond that, there's no particular reason to believe it. I don't personally find it as a principle, even though it's often said that way. But the thing of John Hart basically is the neutral ecology, but then he has an argument for it from maximum entropy. But I say the amazing thing is it's predictive with very few parameters. The standard one for ecologists is there are just lots of niches, and then you say, okay, what about the fine diversity? Well, then you have micro niches, and then you go finer and finer. At some point, you say, wait a minute, this gets absurd. You would need to go down to Yocto niches to explain this amount of diversity. And that's particularly true when you're simple environments, simple organisms, and they're mixed and competing, which smears out any gradients and so on, which would normally enhance the diversity. Another possibility is continual evolution without much ecology. This is really hard to get occurring over a long range of very long timescales, as it does here. And again, you try to put numbers in, it just doesn't make sense. Another classic argument is the statement that pathogens promote diversity. And it sort of sounds reasonable, but there's amazingly little theory and modeling that sort of say, does this actually work? And this is something I'm going to talk about in some detail. One thing is, you know, do you mean specialist pathogens or generalist pathogens? And the problem here is stability to extinctions of the pathogens particularly. The other possibility, which is a very loose defined statement, that it's somehow a general consequence that once biology is sufficiently complex, that you tend to get diversity continuing to evolve on all scales. But of course, it really needs scenarios and some models. Now, the evolution and ecology are all intrinsically linked together. A lot of people like to work on evolution, or other people work on ecology and ignore the others. But particularly for microbes, they're all going on similar timescales and over huge ranges. But the problem is all of these things depend on the organismic properties and on their phenotypes, not just on their genotypes. And the genotypes is unfortunately what we can measure from microbes. Right? So we really want to focus for the coupling the interplay between the ecology and the evolution on the phenotypes. So this takes us then to the theoretical part. So I don't know what complexity is, but I think almost everyone would agree that a cell, even a simple bacterial cell, is complex. But not only that, there is a real sense in which it's very high dimensional. So what do I mean by that? Well, the genome encodes for what we call the molecular phenotype, which are the properties of all the proteins, how they interact with each other, how they interact with DNA, and so on. And that's a very large number, even for simple bacteria. Then that molecular phenotype codes for the organismic, determines the organismic phenotype, which is the properties of the cell or macroscopic organism. And that's and the ways it is affected by its environment and the ways it affects its environment. Right? So both of those are in that. And that's a large dimension, probably not as big as this. Then, of course, there's the environmental space, most simply the number of chemicals that matter for the organism, either being produced or being or affected. So the crucial bit is the assumption, but it's actually a rather weak assumption, is that the complexities of the biology, ecology, and particularly the evolutionary history mean that the differences in fitness between close relatives, how they depend on somewhat different environments, how they couple to other biology and so on, that all of these differences will typically be sums of positive and negative contributions. Why is that the case? Well, if there was some mutation that was beneficial for Prochlorococcus, it would have fixed in the population a long time ago. And actually, you can put in numbers, any triple mutation comes in quickly and would fix in the population a long time ago. Right? So everything that's there has to be conditional on the particular where it is, who else is around in that environment, and so on. So that means we can do, you know, the first refuge of scoundrelous statistical mechanicians and caricature the complexities by randomness and, of course, thinking about the statistical properties of that and hope that there is some kind of universality, even in a loose sense, in because of the high dimensionality. So what are the basic questions? So I would like to focus on the simplest possible conditions. Of course, the more complex the environment is, the easier it is to think how you get diversity. So I want to think of the simplest conditions, no spatial gradients or temporal variations. It's just the environment is the same everywhere and for all times. And then the first question is whether we can ask, it's whether ecological feedback on evolution can cause continual evolution, for evolution to keep continuing even without diversity. So can we get this already when we have a single strain with no diversity? And there are actually some experiments of Rich Lenski's that sort of, in long term, sort of hint at this somehow evolution continuing much longer than what than one would expect. But I think it's
So continual evolution means in time there's diversity, but not in space.
Yeah. So this would be, but it, no, and also any, at any given time there isn't diversity, but the as it evolves, it will continue to evolve. So I'll be more precise about this. So then I can go the other way around. So here I've sort of turned off the diversity. Then I can ask, let me turn off the evolution and ask, can a population sustain extensive diversity even without the evolution continuing? So we should go to the two sides. Okay. And then, of course, I want to put these together and ask, can high diversity evolve and diversification continue? And then a slightly vaguer one, here, which is how much complexity is enough? Okay, and I'll say what I mean for that. Okay, so the first question then is this question about ecological feedback and the continual evolution. So the very simplest, of course, is just evolution. Remember, the phenotype space in a fixed fitness landscape. So I've got some d-dimensional phenotype X, idealized fixed environment. There's just some function, which is the fitness landscape, only one genotype at a time corresponding to one phenotype. A mutation occurs. If that's beneficial, it takes over the population. It's small enough that I don't get diversity there except temporarily. And so the evolution is essentially deterministically uphill in this fitness landscape. And I'll just at any given time have one strain except transiently when the mutation is coming in. Okay. So that is going to be then just uphill in the fitness landscape. But this is, of course, a high dimensional landscape. It's roughly speaking random, certainly very complex and many maxima and things. So this is the well-studied now question of evolution of dynamics in a of gradient dynamics in a high-dimensional rugged landscape. So what happens? Well, there are exponentially many maxima in the dimension, exponentially saddle points, which control where things go, higher-order saddle points, and so on. And what happens is as the evolution proceeds, the fitness goes up and up, but it keeps sort of wandering among the saddles. The index of those saddles goes down. But it never commits to any maximum. It gets close to maximum, never commits to them, keeps going away. It's always very hard to predict what maximum might eventually end up in finite dimensions. And it basically ends up hovering around the saddles and then getting near the sort of marginal peaks where they have their one eigenvalue, which is almost unstable. Very sensitive to initial conditions and perturbations. And if you add stochasticity from mutations, it's like stochastic gradient descent, which is very very simple. So this, of course, the evolution is just going to slow down. It's going to move around, it keeps going, but it gets slower and slower.
If you're just doing raw gradient descent with no inertia terms or anything,
right,
no Newton-Raphson,
right,
why would it not actually just go to a peak and stay there?
Okay, so in any finite dimension that eventually goes to a peak, but in the limit of very large dimensions, the so much of the phase space is the phenotype space here is controlled by the saddles and is away from the peaks, that the time it takes to get to the peaks goes to infinity in the limit of height.
Okay, so it's not so much that it just wanders around a peak, it's being caught in the valleys.
Yeah, it goes around the saddles, and then if it does get near to a peak, it would take a very long time to converge to the peak because almost all the peaks have very, very flat directions. Okay, so they're easy to get pushed away from. So it's counterintuitive, but it really says that one's, and you know, obviously this is a crude caricature, but it's a much better caricature than things you can draw with in two dimensions with a couple of peaks. But of course, the environment isn't constant, the environment is modified. So I should consider the fitness then as a function of phenotype and the environment it's in, which, for example, could be the concentration of all the chemicals. Now, I'm very against using things and sticking ohms on the end, but I think this is one which is actually relevant. Fitness is a very misleading quantity. Even though it's got two S's at the end, it sounds like a singular quantity. But of course, it isn't. It's a complex function of all sorts of things and the conditions and time and so on. So I'm trying to sneak this into the literature.
Sorry. So the form of the fitness, so you're assuming that is a kind of potential field. So.
Yeah. But it depends on the environment.
But it, right, but isn't that a pretty strong assumption. How do you justify?
No, at this point, so my fitness here, I can just say, is the difference in growth rates. The difference in fitness is what matters. The difference in growth rate between the two strains. Okay. Now that's, I'm going to come right away to maybe answering you're getting at the answer to the next step. So this, of course, means it'll depend on the environment. But if the environment's fixed, okay, I have a different landscape, but you know, who cares? Okay. But of course, the organisms change the environment, right? That's the ecology. So if I have a single population that's saturated, it's maximum number it can be, then that'll cause some environment. This, of course, will be a function of the external conditions plus the phenotype of that organism. So this says what we really have is evolution in what one might call a snowscape, where instead of going uphill, you think you're going uphill, but in fact, you know, you're stepping on the snow, and sometimes that comes down, and you think you're going uphill, but you might actually not be getting anywhere. There's some magnitude of the feedback called delta, and we're particularly interested in what happens when this magnitude is small, because I want to ask the questions of principle, you know, which things will be very general, and which things do I need to assume some effects are strong. So we'll be interested in this. So it's obviously roughly what happens. If I have a saddle here, then that'll control which direction the evolution goes there. But if I now have some environmental feedback, as it's coming towards it, the saddle can move a little bit, and it can make it go another direction. So this says things get a bit more complicated. But if you did this in, you know, low-dimensional landscapes, you would find you could sort of spiral into peaks. It wouldn't be very much difference. But we want to ask what happens again in the high dimensions.
So is that instantaneous?
So what I'm assuming is that the time scale, the mutation comes in, a new population then takes over, and the next mutation doesn't come in until after that's taken over. So the environment set by that has already then changed before another mutation comes in. So I'm sort of doing the adiabatic evolution. And it's simplest conceptually, almost all the other things that one adds tend to make it easier to get the evolution to continue. So this is sort of, in some sense, the worst case, except that I'm assuming this very rugged landscape. So the theoretical result is that for arbitrarily small feedback in this high-dimensional limit, you get red queen dynamics, where the evolution evolves forever without slowing down. Initially, it slows down as it improves the environment overall, but then this feedback will make it continue forever. Now, it's no longer gradient descent dynamics. It's because this, it's a change in the environment. Each organism invades the environment set by the one before, and it's no longer gradient descent.
That's a bit weird. So you're saying that with environmental feedback, the dynamics in high dimensions is different than without? Like, because intuitively, right, it would seem to me that if the dimension is high enough,
right,
you're at the saddle. I mean, you can't explore the whole saddle. It's so big.
Right.
How would you even tell if the environment is changing or not?
Okay, so if you look, so this is what the dynamics is, right? So it's you're changing, but you're coming into the environment set by the ones that are already there. Okay, so you've got the one that's already there is setting the environment. You're competing in that environment. Okay, and then if you take over, then you change the environment. Okay, so this is not gradient descent dynamics. Okay? So you can look at what can happen. And the simplest one is that you can spiral. You can get spirals coming in, but you can also get things that continue. And that from the models that we analyze, that's generic in this high-dimensional complex situation.
Even spirals, right? If the dimension is high enough, how would you even go in a spiral? Because
you don't. You just keep wandering around. You get near the saddles. You spend your time near the saddles. So you can actually work out. You can work out what the statistics of the local environment and things are as you're moving around.
The question is: fitness is on individual level. Does it depend on the actions of others?
Yeah. So this is. I'm really assuming that there is a single strain. Right, and so it does depend on the existence of all your siblings, in the sense that collectively you change the environment. But you have a small change yourself, but all your siblings together have a collectively change in the environment. So that's in there, and that's exactly what this is coming in. Right, so this is this is setting this environment. That's the total population that's there at saturation with that phenotype. Then the mutation comes in and competes in that environment, right? And then if it takes over, it changes.
I think that was Michael's question. If the environment is really that large, the occupancy in any generation is measure zero.
Right.
You're assuming a global modification.
No, No, I mean, it's not the global. Where it's changed, the environment is something, the phenotype is something, and as the phenotype changes, it slightly changes the environment by a very small amount.
Why would I visit the changed environment?
No, because you're living in one point in space. I have no spatial structure whatsoever here. Sorry, yeah. So everyone is directly competing, directly interacting with each other. So there's no issue of the moving around in space, but there's the issue of moving around in this high-dimensional phenotype space. And that dynamics is complicated, but you can actually do, honest calculations and understand the behavior. So basically what happens is short times you wander around the saddles, at long times, the dynamics becomes deterministic dynamics as approximation, becomes deterministic high-dimensional chaos, keeps wandering around the whole of the phenotype space. It's going slowly when delta's small, but it keeps on going forever. And the measure of this is what Michael Lasser, I think, calls the fitness flux, is you look at the rate of fitness that you think you're doing. So this is like how many steps you're taking up in the snowfield. And you can, it's proportional to how fast mutations come in and fix in the population. Right? So this is something which is, you're sort of observable in experiments as to whether mutations are continuing to come up and take over at a similar rate. Okay? So this says that, you can get in just simple models, in some ways it's sort of the natural thing you would expect to get in high dimensions with the condition on the evolutionary history giving you the randomness, is you would expect to get this red queen dynamics, even with small environmental changes. So how much complexity is enough? Well, the first models one does this one that are, p-spin spherical models and so on. But you can say, okay, let me try to do a slightly reasonable caricature of what's going on. So I want to consider the molecular scale phenotype, which is this very high dimension. And I want to crudely mimic this by saying it's a well-adapted organism. There's a bunch of constraints on the protein interactions that involve a few of these quantities. And I just say I sum up the squares of those, and I say the fitness is minus that. So this, in principle, if you could satisfy all these constraints at once, you would be perfectly fit, and it's a deviation from that with soft constraints. So this is a crude caricature of the internal biology of the cell. Then in the organismic scale, I want to assume that I have a very simple landscape. Very simple, just one fitness direction in this high-dimensional space, one fitness direction which would make a single peak. Okay. And with I can do it with a modest dimensional environment of the environment, and the ecological feedback is really simple, as if the organism evolves slightly, it slightly changes around where the peak direction is. So we're just slightly moving it around by a small amount. And then my fitness has this organismic level part plus these constraints, and that's enough that if it's sufficiently constrained, then for any feedback, again, you get this red queen dynamics. Now, this isn't the theory for something that actually goes on, but it is a hint at something which has been known for a long time, and the practitioners of it seem to be less puzzled than I think they should be, which is that proteins, if you look at proteins on a long time scale, the proteins seem to continue to evolve, and people will say that's all neutral evolution. But some parts of it are very hard to reconcile with numbers, that it's actually neutral. And what I think is more likely going on is that a lot of it is driven by interesting evolution that happens on some other protein. And as soon as some protein changes that with significant fitness gain, then the other proteins have to evolve to not to stick to it. It's now different. They have to evolve slightly to stick to it. So each protein is being pushed on in different ways as a function of time, evolutionary time, which will then have little bits of selection and sort of push it in random ways. And that can sort of look as if it's some kinds of neutral evolution. Okay, so now I want to come to the next question, which is going to the opposite end. I'm going to turn off the evolution and ask whether you can sustain extensive diversity. And this was done in collaboration with three students shown in different environments here. And the most basic one we want to ask is if I have one species with very closely related strains, or one bacteria and one phage, so a virus that affects the bacteria, each of them with many strains. And that's actually particularly the interesting one. So what do people normally do when they model interactions between many species? So this goes back to with looking at the large number of species limit to Bob May. So I have a bunch of species labeled by alpha. I have k of them. This is the population of species alpha. And the population dynamics is sort of general logical voltaic. They'll grow exponentially at some basic rate, but that'll get suppressed by the carrying capacity. And then there's some interaction between them. And then what is assumed here? Well, by putting this in, we're saying that the interactions with yourself, with your siblings, are special. They're different than the ones that come from this. And that's a tantamount to assuming that each one has its own niche. Each one is primarily interacting with its siblings and typically then weaker interactions with other species. So that implicitly assumes that, and we don't want to assume that. That's sort of assuming the answer. But what May and then many others more recent years found is that even with that assumption, that this is much stronger, this interaction than these, as you increase the number of species, at some critical value, the ecosystem becomes unstable. And that can either drive extinctions or other things that can happen. If you try to put in finer scale niches, it sort of becomes more unstable than this.
Is a particular configuration unstable? So you start in a certain configuration of species.
Yeah.
That is unstable, but you end up in a different...
No, any combination of species that you take when you go past this limit is unstable.
But if you go along the path, will you eventually
no.
end up in a configuration that is stable?
No. You get, things go extinct, and if you then say they're extinct and they're gone, then it's then you eventually get to something which is stable with a much lower diversity typically.
Aren't there constructions of W that do make the system stable?
Yeah. Yeah.
Hard to find.
Yeah. So this, and particularly, this is between different species. So, even treating this as random, which it often does, is, the motivation for that is not that good. There's a much better motivation when you're doing closely related strings.
So, one of the issues with these, right, is generally the W's are like constant fix for the random fix.
Right.
This is like stability in an instantaneous kind of sense that you're.
Yeah, there's no evolution here that we're going to come. But I'm not going to talk about this model. I'm going to talk about a variant of it. So the crucial thing is we don't want to assume any niches, right? So we don't want to assume that your interactions with your siblings are, statistically stronger than your one interactions with fifth cousins. They could be, but they might not be. So the simplest one, which is a lot of work, there is interaction via chemicals in the environment, particularly if they're resources, the community resource models. And there it's known for a long time that the maximum number of strains that can stably coexist is the number of resources in the environment, or more generally, the number of chemicals in the environment that you interact via. So that's rather limiting. So we can ask, can you get many more strains than that? In particular, are there some other possibilities other than stable communities? Right? Stable communities are the easiest ones to analyze, and that's what people tend to look at. But it's not at all clear that that's relevant. So what I want to talk about is the bacteriophage possibility, the bacterial strains and phage strains, one species of each. In particular, let's ask what happens in the ocean. So here I've got a bacteria. The bacteria divides. They go off. Some phage attacks this one here. But then the problem is that as the phage comes out, the phages go, this is wandering off. And it's very hard for the phage to find a close relative of the bacteria that it was born from. So what does this mean? It means that you can't have highly specialized phages. The phages have to be relatively generalist in order to infect things, the planktonic species in the ocean. So what we want to consider is generalist strains, generalist phages with multiple strains. They can each infect any of the bacterial strains, but with varying effectiveness. So there, the Lotka-Volterra model for that is I now have the bacterial different strains, beta, populations of those, phage strains, phi. The bacteria have some interaction just from competition between them. But this interaction, we're assuming no niches, so it doesn't depend on whether it's siblings or fifth cousins. For the competition for resources, you compete equally. So this thing cannot give diversity. Then you've got how the phage is killing you, and then the phages, you've got how you're feeding off the bacteria. So the bacteria are identical, except for their interactions with the phages, and the phages are generalist, but with varying efficacies here. And of course, if bacteria if phage phi does well against bacteria beta, that's bad for bacteria beta. So these matrices are strongly correlated. So the basic dynamics here is reasonably intuitive, but what it looks like in detail is not. The basic dynamics is that the phages want to kill the winner, and the bacteria want to escape the most abundant killer. So I think on the populations here on a log scale, so here's a phage I'm showing in black here. Okay, and if I look at the bacteria that are initially at high numbers, so I'm just doing some subset in blue, these are initially high numbers, the phage, if it attacks those ones well, it'll grow in population. But then what happens is it grows in population, those bacteria will be suppressed because now the phage is killing them. And then other bacteria will start to come up, but those other bacteria aren't as effectively attacked by this particular phage, so the phage will come down. So you'll get this sort of going up and down like that. And one of the goals of theory is to try to understand this kind of dynamics. And this is really, you know, the very big ranges. So these are blooms and busts. And if you're just sitting up here where you can't measure down to very low abundance, you would just see things coming up and bouncing around. And this is actually seen a lot even in buckets of seawater that you bring into the lab of looking at different species. So what we would like to understand is this kind of chaotic bloom-bust dynamics. So if you look at the sort of total matrix of the interactions, putting original octahedral model, it has this part with the bacteria killing the phage and the phage is eating the bacteria, and it has antisymmetric correlations. So, you know, again, scoundrel statistical mechanics, you've got something that's approximate, so you say, let's assume it's exact, and we can ask what happens with a perfectly antisymmetric interaction matrix and look at this form here. And Sid pointed out to me that this was looked at and various results on it by Elliot Montrol back in 1971. So what can one do with this? Well, this model is partially exactly solvable, and it turns out that it has some special features that you can work out. If you take K strains initially, you throw them all in together, you find you end up with a unique community. Half of them typically go extinct, and the other half stay. The ones that stay, however, they're sort of marginally stable from this anti-symmetry. So it turns out the ones that are left, they form a chaotic state with this bouncing up and down, like I showed. But there's actually a whole family of them, which is equivalent to some equilibrium statistical mechanics, where there's sort of a temperature, which is how wide these swings are. Okay, so this is it's technical details, sort of fun things. You can show, you can actually just work out the joint distribution of all of them. And this distribution turns out to be identical to the prediction from neutral ecology, just by coincidence. The dynamics here is completely different, the deterministic driven dynamics, rather than stochastic Burt's guess, but it ends up giving you something which looks the same. So this tells us that in fact neutral-like things can come from very different underlying biology. So I'm gonna flash one slide very fast because for people who don't know it, I would spend a long time explaining it, but I'm happy to come back to it at the end. So that's my theory slide, just so there's something honest behind this. And I'm happy to explain more at the end.
So a little bit like rock, paper, scissors, giving you a uniform distribution.
But you need the, yes. So in fact, if you put this in terms of a strategy model or a game model, if you have a game where, you know, if A beats B, then B loses to A by the same amount, then you get perfectly antisymmetric interactions and replicator model and so on. And that gives you this dynamics when you put a large number of ones with different strands. So, but what happens, this is very special. So the first thing we've got to do if we're honest is we've got to put a perturbation. So as soon as we go away from this perfect antisymmetry, what you find is that at short times, you get this bouncing up and down, but then on log times, on ridiculously wide range, you get this fluctuations, and you drive things to extinction. So this is the problem with the bacterial phage dynamics, is the fluctuations that are driven by this kind of kill the winner dynamics tend to get bigger and bigger, and they drive things to extinction. Okay? So the question we have to ask is, what can stop things going extinct? Can we sustain this diversity? Well, there's a classic way to do that. The classic way from, you know, island biogeography is you say, well, I'm interested in the diversity on an island with some environment. If something goes extinct there, I can get a migrant from the mainland and I can recover from that. But that's really cheating, right? That's saying that I just replaced the problem of diversity on the island with the problem of diversity on the mainland. And so I want to do better than that. Well, so the next thing one does is you say, okay, let's, instead of doing that, let's put a whole bunch of islands. We're going to pretend these islands are identical to make things simple. There's weak migration between them. Things only compete on the same island. And we want to ask, can many strains survive here? Okay, we don't have a mainland. Certainly some strains can go globally extinct, but we want to ask, can we get a lot of them surviving? Okay, so this was worked out with my students and also by Roy and collaborators, some aspects of it in a slightly different but related model. Okay. So this is now a model where I'm going to have a lot of islands. The islands are identical. Many bacterial and phage strains on each. Interactions only within the island, always the same. Large total population, which means that the population dynamics is basically deterministic, as I've written down, except for extinctions. Something gets to zero, you know, zero is special, gets less than one. And then the migration between the islands, and the simplest is just, you know, going from any island to any other. But what happens? Well, then what you find is you get a spatiotemporally chaotic phase. There's chaotic dynamics on each island, but the island's desynchronized. Okay? Some of the strains go globally extinct, but and the, all the surviving strains have special properties.
By the way, I just want to, even though you use the word island, this is still no space in this.
Yeah, there's no space, but there's a mean field version of space.
Right.
Exactly. So this is now looking at the dynamics on one of the islands and just like some of the strains here. A lot of them have gone extinct. This is the survivors here. And they're going up and down, you know, roughly uniformly distributed on a logarithmic scale. And it turns out this looks very much like the antisymmetric model with the migration sort of cutting off the range of fluctuations. So this migration then cuts it off. The crucial part is that the islands desynchronize because of the chaos. Okay. So how do we see that? Well, if I look one here, here's one that goes globally extinct, it bounced around, but eventually you get extinctions on too many islands and the whole thing dies out and can't be sustained. But here's now looking at one strain and across the islands. It's going around like this. Here's where it drops down to one individual on an island. That one goes locally extinct. But what happens is some other one blooms, and these blooms then, the migration from those can recover from extinction and it can keep going. So some fraction, actually a large fraction in the simplest models of the strains will survive indefinitely coming from this. So the survival of local extinctions come, but the crucial bit is that each strain that survives has to have blooms up to high abundance. You can only survive globally with blooms.
How does it depend on the number of islands?
I'm gonna come to that. Yeah. So this, if I look at this now, and I say, okay, well, let me just take a snapshot of this. That's the easiest data to take. I take it on one island, take a snapshot, and measure the abundance of all the strains on that island and ask what that looks like. Okay. Well, that looks like here's on a log versus linear scale with a rank. There's a slope of, would be the slope of one. This looks just like the behavior of the neutral, except for at low abundances where the migration effects come in. So this is something which gives you, like the antisymmetric model, gives you something which looks a lot like neutral abundance distributions for the simple quantities. But the dynamics is very different.
How many parameters
in this model? So this model, there's other the numbers of islands, I think we'll come to, only has one, essentially only has one parameter. If we do it for the bacteriophage model, there's a few parameters. If I do the simplest model, where I don't sort of distinguish who's a bacteriophage, then there's only one. Then there's only one parameter, and it's robust over a range of that. So one of the reasons for sort of not trying to do bacteriophage first is that you have to make quite a few choices, and you do things you can't do the theory fully. You get simulations, you don't quite know what's going on, and so then we go back to the simpler one, which is really just a Lotka-Volterra one. With randomly anti-correlated interactions, but not perfectly anti-correlated. So that's the ends up being the one parameter. So this now that this phage now coming to Jeffrey's question. Sorry.
Where you call that one parameter? So the anti-correlation matrix.
Yeah.
Why would you call every element of that matrix?
Oh, so I have a random matrix. So I draw the random that are independent, except that there's a correlation across the diagonal, which is negative. And so there's one parameter that's for that the covariance there, and that's across all the species. The motivation is here is better than the motivation for the species, right? Because they're strains, then they're going to be sums and differences of things. The sort of randomness approximation is a rather natural natural one here. Of course, evolution can change that, and you would expect, right? Anything I write down like this is a model, I have to ask, can I get to that from evolution? So that's the last bit I'm going to mention. Okay. So if I look at this behavior, it's very robust. Actually, in the number of islands gets large, the strains will persist for exponentially longer than the number of islands. There'll be some marginal ones that'll go extinct that could have survived the number of islands, but as you wait, it gets slower and slower, the extinctions. Of course, what we would like to do is have some real spatial structure with spatial dispersal, and one can ask about environmental gradients and so on. What we'd really like for the dynamics is actually ask what happens with ocean mixing with the turbulence, because one would like to say, you know, what are spatiotemporal correlations of abundances? Can one actually make some predictions? And one could do enough sequencing at this stage, at this point, that one can start imagining doing things where you actually pick up some dynamical correlation. So now I want to come back to my question about, you know, how much complexity do we need to get this? So here I want to be a little more honest about the bacteriophage. So what's the simplest model of a bacteria in a phage? Bacteria of strain beta has some receptor, which I'm just going to say a little vector, the list of amino acids in its receptor. The bacteria, the phage has a tail that binds to that. Another vector, these are d-dimensional vectors, and this d is sort of labeling, some tell me how complex the interactions are, the phenotypes for the organismic level that matter. So that's d-dimensional. And an interaction is then just by the binding energy, so just the dot product of the r and the t. Then, and here's where I start having to choose things. So we've got some function then, which is how the bacterial death rate depends on the this binding energy and how the phage population rate depends on it. Okay. So this, we know, we can see easily, and it gives you can give you the spatially temporally chaotic phase. And it's with generalist phages, so each of them can interact with a good fraction of the other bacteria effectively, some others more weakly. If you make the simplest assumption, they're close relatives, so you would say the F and G are linear, then it's a bit like interacting via resources. The maximum coexistence diversity is of order the length of these vectors. So, you know, if that's tens of amino acids, you can have tens of them coexist, right? That's boring. That's not what we want. However, if you do much more natural, you take some kind of sigmoidal interaction. You know, if the bacteria is dead, it's dead. It doesn't, the virus killing it even better doesn't do any better from that. Then you can get high diversity even for low-dimensional, very low-dimensional, simple receptor tails. We don't yet understand how high you can get, but you can get much higher diversity in the spatiotemporally chaotic phase than one would expect from the simple ones. So this tells us that simple biology, simple in the sense of how they're interacting, without assuming any niches, right? This is the only way in which the strains differ from each other, that you can get high diversity. That we shouldn't, you know, intrinsically be surprised by that, or at least not as surprised.
Is there a one-to-one correspondence between which phage infects which bacteria, or?
No, so actually, if I look over here, sorry, I should have explained. So this is actually, this is the infectiveness matrix, and so that how dark they are here is how dark, you know, phage 20 infects bacteria 43 or something like that. And the, and you notice it's just spotty black and white all over the place. And in fact, if you look at this, these are the ones that survive. Those are the ones that go extinct. You wouldn't even be able to guess which from this, because it's the sort of the effect of all of them interacting with all of the others that, that controls.
So there's some sort of indirect competition amongst phage also.
Yeah, so the phages, the total number of bacteria is limited because the bacteria are limited by total number of resources.
Right.
So the phages are intrinsically competing because the number of bacteria is limited. If the bacteria aren't limited, the bacteria are too limited, the phages actually can't come in. If the bacterial density is too low, the phages won't come in at all. But if they're the fact the bacteria are limited in the same way does give you the competition between the phages. They don't directly compete, but it's via the phages.
The bacteria don't have niches.
The phages don't.
The phages do.
Well, okay, but if you
that's your binding energy matrix.
No, so if I look at this, so if I go across a row here of a phage, and I go across a row of another phage, and I would say, you know, is my niche, if you're allowed to make niches of an arbitrarily long list of numbers, then yeah, you can say it's niches. They differ from each other.
Yeah.
Right? So they do have an ecological difference. But I think then you start saying, if you specify huge numbers of numbers, it's going to depend on all kinds of details unless you make some statistical description of it. And then I think the sort of language in terms of the niches, where it's relatively specific what's going on, becomes not really useful. But they certainly are ecological differences. It's not neutral. In some average sense, they're very similar, but they're actually not even equivalent in average sense. The population of the phages average over time varies from phage to phage. Some of them die out, they're zero, but the other ones does zero. Okay. So the last question is whether or not, you know, I can get such high diversity to evolve. And this is at a much earlier stage. So question, if I start with these bacteriophage communities, so I just evolve them. Well, now I've got phenotypes, right? So I can evolve the phenotypes. When I started with just an interaction matrix, you know, quite how do you think of evolving that? Because the interactions are via the phenotypes. So now I can just evolve the bacteria receptors in the tails. And I can ask, does the diversity increase? Does it saturate? Or maybe it crashes? And the answer is any of those can occur. It depends on parameters and to some extent on the functions in a way I say we only very partially understand. So here's an example that looks like the diversification is continuing. So what we do here is you run to ecological equilibrium, so you've got this chaotic state. You introduce one new strain of a bacteriophage. If it's lucky, it can invade. It comes into the population. It can drive other ones extinct. Some others go extinct. Then you wait and you do it again. So this is the limit of very slow evolution. Why do I want to do that? Well, if you make the evolution fast, you can always have a lot of diversity because evolution produces all the time. So here, the hardest case is I'm letting everything equilibrate and go extinct before introducing the next one. So this is the evolutionary time, the number of ones that I've introduced, and you can see from the structure here, so this is over 350 of these sort of epochs. And you notice that the number of the strains is growing up roughly linearly in time. We know in some simpler models, these random Volterra ones with the one parameter, in fact, you can get a phase where this just grows steadily in time, just keeps on growing and doesn't slow down, just keeps on diversifying. We know that some effects will stop that, some sort of generalist fitness effects and so on. What we don't know is whether this is actually going to continue or going to saturate. And we have some sort of examples of the different and that our theory understanding of it is still very limited.
This is do you have a population size or just somehow continuous?
No, there's a fixed population size.
Because how can it continue to diversify once you have the number of
Oh, okay. No. So the population size is enormous. Right, so the population size is enormous because we're thinking about these microbes. Now, of course, you can't diversify beyond the number of organisms, and you won't get nearly to that. But in the limit, you know, if each island has 10 to the 20, which isn't that big a number for microbes, then you know that's way outside of any regime. But this, I say, we don't know. We do know that you can have these coming up and flattening out, and so the diversity saturates, fluctuates around, but basically. So what is that? That one where it saturates, that's actually an example of the Red Queen evolution. Nothing much is happening. The evolution is keep continuing to going. You're continuing to get a new phage comes in, another one goes extinct. Sometimes three go extinct. Sometimes several come in with no going extinct and so on. The evolution can continue forever without slowing down. And this we're pretty sure it can do this. And without any specialization. So interestingly, you don't drive it in a direction of tending to be more specialized. You stay in this regime where each one is interacting roughly randomly with others. The statistics change slightly, but not by much. The thing we don't understand yet is whether you can get the diversification to continue in these quasi-realistic bacteriophage model, at least have the sort of caricature. We do know it in a simpler model, but we know that's slightly special depending on how you think about things. Okay. So where have we got to?
Okay.
So the one thing I hope I convince you of is that, looking at some of these simple models, firstly, it's a lot of fun, but they also maybe greet you to one surprise somewhat, push away where the surprise is. And I say, to me, that's one of the most crucial roles of theory in biology. With these bacteriophage models, we find you can get at least pretty high diversity with very simple biology. We're not invoking any complexity of the biological interaction. The crucial part for the particular phage, this spatiotemporal chaos, is it's stabilized because of the blooms and busts. Right? Instead of having a stable community with the populations all roughly the same over time, here they're bouncing up and down like crazy, but that, together with the spatial structure, is what's stabilized. Whether this is testable, we hope so, if we can understand enough about abundance correlations and the dynamics. And actually, Jeff Gore has been doing some experiments in the lab which to look at this kind of behavior from soil bacteria pulled into the lab. And he sees some of the effects of the this when you get in this chaotic phase, that it tends to stabilize a more diverse community than you get without. Without it. So the evolution, so this was the diversity, the evolution we're pretty sure you can get this continual red-green evolution. Whether you can get the continual diversification, we don't know. Of course, what we would like to say, what are the phylogenetic signatures? Right, from the sequencing, you can try to construct the family trees of the bacteria and the phage. Are there properties of those that would be indicative of this kind of dynamics going on? Or do they just look like, you know, generic neutral phylogenies, even though this is a very different process? And that we're looking at, we don't know yet. It looks as if a lot of the properties, it would be very hard to tell distinction from neutral. So you would really have to sort of then think about, you know, does the neutral thing make sense for numbers? Or you would really have to get at the dynamics. So I've talked about the role of pathogens in these models. But we can go back and ask, can I get extensive diversity of closely related strains, not by pathogens, but from interactions via chemicals in the environment? We know you can't do that with if you have a if looking for stable a single stable population, but you might be able to get it in a chaotic state. You can possibly get chaotic states in which the chaos is sort of very slow, that you get stable communities, say on one island, that's stable for a long time, but occasionally an invader can come in that'll destabilize it. And then there's other islands, other ones in, some of them will go globally extinct, but no communities are permanently stable. This is a possible caricature for what goes on in human guts. Okay, so if you look at the most abundant bacterial species in your guts, or some of the bacteroides species that essentially everyone has, and you look from person to person, you can have two people in the household, same household, whose ones diverged 100,000 years ago, and two people across the world whose strains diverged 100 years ago. And there's evolution of these going on. Each individual doesn't have that many strains. But you can still ask on the timescales of the mixing of the populations, why hasn't most of that diversity of those strains within the species been driven away? And one possibility is getting into this sort of kinds of state where you get sort of relatively stable communities, but they can always be invaded by some other which will destabilize. And then the last question, which is something I haven't raised at all. I talked at the beginning, I showed a picture of distances between genomes, as they was got from single cell bacteria. But is this in fact what we should be trying to understand? Humans, we clearly are not trying to understand the diversity of genomes. Every genome is different, right? Because of sex and the recombination. And so what about the situation for bacteria? So I just want to show one last thing here, which is going back to the data and asking whether we're in fact even barking up the right tree. So this is going back to the Prochlorococcus. This is looking at this very abundant highlight two species. And this was the distance between the genomes. And you can see this is almost a uniform color. There's some more closely related ones here. This is roughly like if you took everyone of European ancestry and measured the average distance between their genomes, you would get something like this, because it's so mixed up along the genome. So how can you quantify that? Well, we've got these single cell genomes. So you can do stuff that you can't do with things like metagenomics, where you collect a huge amount of sequence, gives you a lot of local information on the genomes, but this is really giving you the whole genome information. Okay. So one of the things you can look at is you can look at the sort of level of the individual genes along the genome, and you can say you could try to construct phylogenetic tree for each gene along the genome across these hundreds of cells. Okay. And these are ones which are rather dramatic difference. Here you get trees with a very deep branching. So here's a tree of some subset of cells, here's a tree of others, with a common ancestor quite far back. Here's a tree of another gene there also, where, again, I've shown it for clarity, one in which there were two sort of major branches. Now, what would you expect if bacteria were evolved asexually? Well, everyone knows for a long time that bacteria change around interesting genes. They get new functions and so on. But this is looking at the core genes. It's looking at the genes that every single one of the species have. They're all very similar to each other. Okay. Nevertheless, if you start looking at the phylogenies of these, you find these phylogenies are completely mixed up. You would expect to find this one with this one, say, and this one with this one, and you don't find that. What you find, a crude caricature, is you find that the linkage between these correlations, are just completely broken up by recombination on large scales along the genome. So, you know, a little a over here might be sometimes with on the same genome, little b, sometimes the same big b. And this linkage breaks up amazingly well. It's almost indistinguishable from sort of random null models at the level we have it with sort of hundreds of cells. So this is saying that on long scales, these bacteria are acting more like some kind of sexual organism on long genomic scales, which is sort of called in other contexts quasi-sexual. There are some other bacteria, actually some other cyanobacteria that we looked at earlier, in which the sort of correlations of this linkage along the genome in relative to the number of mutations is less than humans. Then some, by some measure, they're more sexual than humans are, some other bacteria. These ones less, but they still are very sexual. So this says what we should be trying to do is understand the diversity of each gene or combinations of genes rather than the diversity of the genomes, and it becomes a different problem.
Right, you're not taking in, so when you compare a gene in one species to a gene in another species, you don't take into account the location. You just find the closest gene in the genome.
Right. So here, the genomes are small, so there's not many duplicate genes. So it's usually very easy to identify them, even across this much broader scale of the whole of Procococcus. And then you can look at those, and you look at core genes, and you see there's recombination within them. Here, the correlation lengths are sort of order 5, 10 genes along the genome, which is the sort of scale of the chunks in which they probably recombine. But one has a huge advantage here of this wide range of genomic differences scales from the focuses to look on some of the finer scale structures here. There's sub stuff here where they intentionally looked at this Kashtan and Faber's intentionally looked at trying to find ones that were closely related. And then you end up with some of these ones that are very closely related, where you can identify specific genetic exchange events. And so we have the fact that we've got that all the way up to these 100 million year scale means a lot of things you can infer about the Procococcus that you can't with other bacterial species. And we know they're all mixing and competing. You pick up one bucket of seawater, one location at 50 meters depth, and you pick up examples of all of the groups and even some of the ones that have subgroups. Okay, so I'll leave you with that. It's maybe that the question that I started with was the wrong one, and what we really have to be thinking of much more of the bacterial as sexual organisms, and then really thinking about the diversity, what sustains the diversity of various things along the genome. Some of that may again be associated with interaction with phage, and that we're starting to try to look for whether some evidence for that. Thank you.
Seems to me that you're exploring different mechanisms that could provide the diversity.
Yeah.
Whatever, and I think that's very valuable.
I wonder whether a complementary explanatory approach would be to assume simply, okay, what would happen with homogeneous populations? What would be their disadvantages in an evolutionary search or context? Because it seems to me that if you have like a homogeneous population, very low diversity. At the same time, it would be less robust and less evolvable, in the sense that there's a mutation that it's deleterious, or if there's a phage that can exploit some vulnerability, it would affect the whole population. Right. And also, if you have very similar genotypes, you wouldn't be able to explore as efficiently the genotype space, as opposed if you have a diversity of sequences, then different
genes are different. Right.
So maybe that could be like, okay, it makes sense to have heterogeneity, and then which mechanisms?
Right. So this is a very important point, and I think is often one of the things about evolution, which is some are not fully appreciated, is that everything we see is conditional upon tremendous evolutionary success.
Yep.
Right? Like insects, obviously, individual species doesn't last very long, but they're tremendously successful as a group. And so if one starts asking which things does one expect conditional on long-term evolution, so one of the things which I swept under the rug, but I said this when I was looking at the model with the constraints and the protein constraints, that if it was sufficiently constrained, it tended to keep wandering around forever. If it wasn't sufficiently constrained, it tends to go to a fitness peak and stay there. So now I ask myself, which do I think is more likely from the conditional long-term evolution? And then exactly the positives which you say. If I'm in a state where, in this, maybe over here, spatially it's wandering around this way in evolution, over here it's wandering around somewhat differently, it very easily can modify if in response to a changing environment, because it's sort of going near saddles and so on. And I would expect that I would find evolution, my natural populations, would be in the state with this continual evolution rather than in the state where it was very well adapted to a peak. So I think that's it. I think it's a very important important point, and I think one can sort of use that argument about the conditioning on evolution to try to guess at what happens. What you then have to say is, you know, people often assume perfect trade-offs, and with perfect trade-offs, it's easy to get lots of coexistence. But you have to ask, is perfect trade-offs stable to perturbations away from perfect trade-offs? And it isn't. And so you have to, whatever things you hypothesize, you have to say, okay, is that sort of consistent that the evolution will get you there and keep you there? And particularly the keep you there. I think that's the, you know, less hard than the getting you there. But at least one should have something consistent that says, okay, I'm at least stable under, you know, relatively short-term evolution.
Yeah, I'm just curious, do you have anything to say about microbiome involvement formalism?
I mean, not with, well, so this question I mentioned at the end about the guts. So I could take a model where I say, you know, 10 species which interact in, and, you know, do definitely different things, and you tend to have a community with all 10 of those species. And then I can ask, and you could do this, say, in bee guts, which I think is of order 10 species, and you can look then across the bees, and they don't all have the same variants of those species. And then you start asking, you know, why not? And there, there's something we're working on a little bit of getting sort of separated communities, but where you can still sustain the diversity even if they mix together. So that's sort of, you know, for the small microbiomes, that's relevant. You know, this is what I'm doing here is talking about the most boring part of the diversity and the most boring part of evolution. But on the one hand, if you don't understand this, you're not going to understand more complicated evolution. And in fact, it's the beginning of more complicated evolution, more interesting, is diversity within a species. And so I certainly don't claim that I understand things about microbiomes. I think this does raise, you know, potential scenarios that one might try to explore. But, you know, it's toy models, and it's the, you know, the more goal is to ask what one should be surprised by and sort of make scenarios. And the sort of next step is asking, you know, are there particular contexts where maybe one can do more than wave one's hand. The human guts are actually nasty. I mean, human skin is much better one, which Tammy Lieberman has been doing a lot, and there you can actually get dynamic data and you can follow things on very short time scales, and you can see what happens when kids first come into schools and the spatial mixing and so on. So, and then again, you get a huge number of strains. These are commensal skin bacteria. So the similar puzzles come in, but you can actually start to get numbers. And so you have a chance there of getting numbers and following the dynamics. And that's, I think, is really what's needed. You need the spatial structure and the dynamics and the you know, genetic changes to be able to go further.
Any other questions?
Well, my diversity question is I was really struck by the opening graph of distribution.
The diatoms, yeah.
It's so simple, but furthermore, how closely fit everything's like, I mean, it was extraordinary.
Yeah.
Points, at least the way
I know. Okay, so this.
So that's the question. Yeah. So that would suggest, totally naively, there must be some very simple general argument.
Yeah. I mean, roughly speaking, if things are bouncing up and down, being uniformly spread out on a log scale is what you expect.
Well,
and so that it's
a little more.
But you'd expect deviations from it.
More variance.
I know. So it's a lot of this is, I think, the best example. I cherry picked it. To be honest, I'm slightly skeptical of the, you know, cherry picking in the people who write the papers as against me cherry picking from which data to show. But I had a talk of John Hart's actually, and, you know, and talked to him a bit about it. And, you know, there was not a lot of fudging. That was on the spatial things. And, you know, things were nothing nearly as good fits as this. But given how few parameters it was, they were remarkably, remarkably good. So
but
I think the fact that things end up looking in some rough way as essentially equivalent when they're all coexisting together for a long time maybe is something which one should expect. But how that would translate in, especially in a complex situation like forests, you know.
Is there some, in your framework, is there some, having seen that, if you take it seriously, which I agree.
Yeah.
Want to, is there some asymptotic regime or some simple argument that you can sort of dig out from this now?
Okay.
Some
in some limit,
yeah,
we get exactly this on this. Because you
should. No, you do. I mean, in this models with this chaos, you do, with the stabilization for migration, you do over a big range, which is set by the migration, the lower end, you do get something which is very close to this. Right? So it's, but you know, there's a question of what's a species.
Analytically, do you see it?
Yeah, no, you see analytically, yeah. But there's a question of what's a species, right? So there's argument going on about this in Proclococcus, whether it should be one genus or one species, and people have all sorts of things. And I was sort of pushing back on this at a conference and saying, you know, why should I care? I mean, being a physicist, I don't really care so much about what names are used. If there's some, you know, biological meaning, like these guys exchange DNA with each other a lot, but very rarely with this other group, okay, that's more like, you know, macroscopic organisms, or sexual organisms, species. But I quoted then some, I forgot his name, who was one of the experts on mollusks. And he was asked by someone, how do you tell whether two mollusks are, you know, same genus or the different genuses or different species in the same genus? As well, if I can tell the difference between them at arm's length, then they're a different genus. If I have to bring it close to my face, then they're only a different species. So you realize anything which does cataloging of defining things by species of things that are not hugely well studied in large, particularly, you know, you could go in there and say, wait a minute, I think this one's actually a different species than that, so you should be doing your plot differently. So this is why I say I'm you know, pretty skeptical on that. But I do think that there are quite a lot of things that will end up giving you things that sort of have some aspects that look neutral. But then the crucial thing is, okay, which features look really different between this scenario and that scenario? And look at those.
So that's the question of extending Jeff. So you have one data slide at the beginning.
Well, I actually had two because I showed the Proclococcus, but yeah.
And then a lot of modeling.
Right.
And so the ratio seems off to me.
Right.
And we learned this from Zipf's law. People got excited about it 20 years ago.
Right.
And then realized that there are a huge variety of models whose stationary distribution gives you it.
Right.
So we're not interested in it anymore.
Right.
So I guess the point is, what is the slightly higher resolution data set that actually justifies doing this work?
Okay, so how I got interested in this was with a colleague, Devaki Bayer, who works on cyanobacteria from Yellowstone Hot Springs. And they had two isolates, and then they did some amplifying up some of the genes to the closely related species, amplifying up some of the genes, seeing what was there. And data was taken, I think, 2007, 2008. And I went back and looked at it recently, and it was a total of 20 megabases of data, which is a few bacterial genomes, single X, tiny amount of data. The sequencing got all messed up, and so it ended up with all from one sample instead of from 10, which was tremendously lucky because we could go and do a lot more. And that's where we discovered this extreme quasi-sexual limit for the population. And they were all, this was taken from one little sample, they're all, you know, competing with each other, they're moving around and stuff like that. And what the hell was it doing with so much diversity there? So there's a lot of data on looking at the fine scale bacterial diversity that's motivating. The question is, are there things that one can go and look at if you say, okay, here's a theoretical prediction and you can go and do that. But my main goal here, I say, was really to talk about the scenarios, right? I don't claim that this is a correct explanation of anything, but it's possible scenarios, which then one can hope, you know, and go and you know, start connecting with data sets. One of the things that came from that analysis was that there's a huge amount of information in things that are there in a very small fraction of the population. And this is actually true in HIV evolution within individual people. If you want to understand that evolution, it turns out the useful information is the things you sample deeply and the things that are there at 1/10,000th or 1/1,000th of the viruses, rather than the ones which are at bigger abundances. And so the sort of theoretical things, which is a lot more pop gen theory and so on, and is, you know, I mean, typically has a lot of assumption as well, but at least it's clear what the assumptions are, that is starting to get to the stage of telling you which things are that you can look at that will be able to sort of distinguish the scenarios for what's going on.
I think we should
call my other hat. Yeah, happy to keep continuing.
Keep on taking more questions.